to destroy the works of the evil one, and the kingdom of darkness with light, and to rescue men from the law of sin. This is the gospel of Christ, to proclaim good news unto the poor.
The gospel of Christ, spreading the soul-saving message of Jesus. And now, Ben Bailey.
This is the gospel of Christ.
The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man overcomes much. James chapter 5, verse number 16. We welcome you today to our study of prayer. The disciples said to Jesus, "Lord, teach us to pray." And today we're going to be thinking about, in this series of lessons, the beautiful subject of prayer. And so we encourage you to get your Bible and stay tuned as we study this wonderful subject together. As we think about prayer, we begin by asking, what is prayer? Is prayer just wishful thinking? Is prayer just some hopeful idea? Is it a maybe? Is it a guess? Is there a doubt involved in that? What exactly is prayer to the child of God? You know, when you think about prayer, there are some interesting ideas that go along with that. Prayer gives the child of God great strength. Jesus said in Luke 18:1, men ought to pray always and never lose heart. In fact, it was Leonard Ravenhill who once said, "If weak in prayer, we are weak everywhere." Prayer has a certain amount of strength that it gives to the child of God, and how true it is that we need prayer in our life. But you know, prayer is also a necessity. It's something that the child of God cannot go day to day without having in his life. Like breathing, like eating and drinking, prayer ought to be second nature to the child of God. Francois Fenelon said this, "Of all the duties enjoined by Christianity, none is more essential and yet more neglected than prayer." We all talk about prayer. We think about it. We sing about prayer. We know that the Scripture says we can come boldly to the throne of grace that we might find grace and mercy to help in time of need. But do we really make prayer an active part of our life? Or is prayer something we just kind of neglect at times? I believe it was Corrie ten Boom who once said, "Is prayer your steering wheel or your spare tire?" Do we really utilize the power of prayer as found in Scripture, or is it something we just lean upon when bad times come? And no doubt we can use prayer at any time. 1 Thessalonians 5:17 says we ought to pray without ceasing, but prayer needs to be more than just a last resort for the child of God. And so let's take just a moment to kind of let the Bible and the language of the New Testament define what prayer is. If we were to look up the word prayer in the dictionary, Webster would define it this way. Prayer is to address God with adoration, confession, supplication, or thanksgiving. It is the communication between God and His children to express their praise, to express their thanksgiving, and no doubt to find help in time of need. And while that's a textbook definition of prayer, the Greek language does help us a little with this subject. The Greek word sukonome, prosukonome, is the word that's most common used for prayer. And really, it's a combination of two words. The word pros literally means to express one's desire or longing toward, in the direction of. And so, when we talk about prayer from the original language, it's the expressing of one's desire with a direct purpose toward Almighty God. And so our desire, our longing, is expressed through the avenue of prayer directly to God, and it's our way of showing our praise and thanksgiving to Him. Another Greek word that is used to describe prayer is eretao, and this word is defined to ask or to make one's request. And thus, when we think about prayer in this aspect, we're making our request toward God. We're asking Him for help. We're letting our cares fall upon Him, as 1 Peter chapter 5, verse number 7 teaches. But then there's a third word that we emphasize from the Greek language, and this is the word parakaleo. This word paints a beautiful picture of the idea of prayer. In fact, the word means to call to one's aid, or to entreat, to ask for help. A perfect example of this is found in Matthew 26, verse number 53. Notice what Jesus here said. Jesus used this word when He said, "Do you think that I cannot now pray to my Father and He will provide me with more than 12 legions of angels?" You know, when you look at prayer from this viewpoint, it's asking God to come to our side, to come to our aid. We know Hebrews 2 verses 16 through 18 says that we can find grace to help in time of need, and that Christ is able to aid those who are in need. And thus, this picture of prayer is that we're petitioning the throne of God, and God's forces are coming to the aid of His children. And thus, what a beautiful picture these ideas paint of prayer. But you know, as we give an introduction to the idea of prayer, let's also realize that prayer is not just a figment of somebody's imagination. Prayer is not just wishful thinking. It's not talking to the sky, we might say. In prayer, there is real power, strength, and praise that is given to and received from Almighty God. Christians believe prayer is real because the Scripture says so. Matthew chapter 6, verse 9, in the disciples' prayer, Jesus taught them, "Pray, our Father who is in heaven." Jesus didn't think prayer was a figment of somebody's imagination or a hoax or a trick. Jesus believed prayer was real communication with Almighty God. James 5:16 tells us it's real, for the effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man, here's how it's real, overcomes much. Prayer has real results. It has real power, and the child of God can take true faith in that. Isaiah 38 verse 5, God said, "I've heard your prayer and your supplication." 1 Kings chapter 9, verse number 3, speaking to the king there, God said, "Your prayer and your supplication that you've made before me, in essence, I have heard." We know God heareth not the prayer of the ungodly. Implied from that is, He hears the prayer of the righteous. Acts chapter 10, verse number 31, and John chapter 9. And so, when we think about prayer, let's realize prayer is real, that it's something Christians can take comfort and encouragement in. Now, someone says, well, how do we know prayer's real? Let me offer just a few ways that one can know from experience and from the things that happen that prayer is real. For example, the Bible teaches us to pray for those who are sick. If anyone's sick, let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him. James 5, verses 13 through 16. We know that prayer is real because it helps those who are in need to get better, to overcome sickness and to overcome the struggles and the diseases that they may have. Prayer is real because it has real power in evangelism. Matthew chapter 9, verses 36 through 38. Jesus, He looked out upon the multitudes and He said to His disciples, "Truly, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few." And listen to this, "Pray the Lord of hosts. He'll send laborers into His vineyard or His harvest." Prayer has powerful results in reaching the lost. How many of us have prayed for someone who was lost, who never obeyed the gospel, whose heart was hardened, and God, through the power of prayer and the Word, and those who were working with it, began to work on their heart? Prayer is also real because we know it helps us in overcoming our troubles. Do you remember 1 Peter chapter 5, about verse number 7? Peter says, "Cast all your cares upon Him, the Lord. He cares for you." When we find ourselves in trouble and in difficulty and in turmoil and difficulty of heart, how do we overcome that? Cast all your anxieties or cares upon Him. He cares for us. The Christian can pray and know that the burden and the weight that he's carrying, God is more than able and willing to help with that. Remember again Luke 18:1, Jesus said, "Men ought to pray always and never lose heart." when we get discouraged and we go down on our hands and knees to the Father in prayer, there is strength, there is help, and there is power to be attained through Almighty God. But you know, we also know prayer is real because we believe in our faith in Almighty God. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. One who truly has faith in God's Word. We're not talking about a leap into the dark. We're talking about faith in the inspiration of the Bible. Faith in the evidence that shouts to us, there is a God. Faith in that creates a faith in God's Word, and faith in God in prayer go hand in hand. This is why James would say, if anyone lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all liberally without reproach, and it will be given to him. But let him ask in faith with no doubting, for he who doubts is like a wave of the sea, tossed to and fro and driven by the wind. When we ask in faith, we can have confidence. We can know God is more than able and willing to help His people. And so, in understanding what prayer is, it also helps us to understand the reality of prayer. When a man bows his head, when a person gets down on his hands and knees at night, he's not just talking to the air. He's communicating with the Creator of the universe, who spoke and all things came into existence, who sent His Son to die for the sins of the world, and who ultimately wants to help His people go to heaven. Now, as we think about prayer, let's also realize we're not talking about naturalism. And by that we mean this. We're not just saying that the things that are naturally going to happen are going to happen anyway. When we talk about prayer, we're talking about God intervening and helping in someone's life. The naturalist approach to life just simply says that we are completely governed by the laws of nature, which cannot be changed. What's going to happen is going to happen, and there's nothing we can do to change that. Friend, this is where prayer has power. If things are going to happen no matter what, what's the purpose in praying? Christians realize the Bible teaches that prayer has the ability to change the outcome, to change the course, to supplicate the will of God, and as a result, God intervene on man's behalf. If such is the case that whatever's going to happen is going to happen anyway, then when Dan Barker said in Losing Faith that if the answer to prayers are merely what God's will is all along, then why pray? Friend, we believe that prayer has the ability to change things. Prayer has the power to move the hand of God in the direction of and for the comfort and help of His people. And while we don't live in the age of miracles, we understand that. We're not living in a day and age where God's going to raise the dead or put the lame person's arm back together. That happened in the first century. We do believe God intercedes in human affairs. Ambrose Pierce said it this way. In the Devil's Dictionary, he defined prayer as to ask that the laws of the universe be annulled on behalf of a single petitioner confessed unworthy. We're speaking on behalf of God. God, through His Word, speaks to us. And as we think about prayer, when we pray, we're asking God to intercede, to do something on the behalf of His children, and to make sure that as God's children, we are indeed striving to do His will and put first things first. And so, when we pray for somebody to get sick or to get well, somebody who's sick, we pray for them to get well, what are we asking? Are we asking God to just let things naturally work out the way they're going to? No, we're asking God to intervene through means, providential means, through the means that He is more than able to use. We're asking God to help in this matter. And it is different from miracles in that miracles were designed to specifically confirm the Word. That Word has been confirmed today. We know that God's Word, the Bible, is true. But prayer in the working of God and providence is different in that God, through His own means and time, whatever that may be. And friend, I don't have to know to realize and understand and believe in the power of prayer. Whatever that may be, I know that God is more than able to work and to help in times like those. Now friend, as we think about it and as we introduce the idea of prayer, let's also realize that God does answer all prayers that are heard. And we say it this way for a purpose. The Bible does teach that God does not hear certain prayers. I want you to, for example, look with me in Psalm chapter 66, verse number 18. If you have your Bible handy, note this passage with me. If I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear. Now watch verse 19. But certainly, David said, God has heard me. He has attended to the voice of my prayer. Is it the case that everybody who prays God hears? Not necessarily. The Bible teaches if we regard iniquity in our heart. What's that mean? If I know I've got sin in my life, I'm living in sin, and I'm blatantly ignoring the will of God and doing what I want instead of what the will of God wants me to do. The psalmist clearly said, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear. God does not acknowledge, God does not bless the prayer of someone who's living in sin. But to those whom God does hear the prayers, David said in Psalm 66, 19, I know He's heard my prayer. To those who are trying to walk in the light, 1 John 1, verse 7, God answers their prayers. God does not ignore the prayers He hears. The Bible pictures God as attentive to our needs, as listening to our prayers, and as ready to help those who are His children. Let me give you an example. 1 Peter chapter 3 pictures God beautifully listening to and ready to help those who pray to Him. Listen to 1 Peter 3, verse number 12. The Bible says, for the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous. Watch this now. His ears are open to their prayers, but the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. What's the picture of God? His eyes are open. He's attentive. His ears, they're ready to hear their prayers. And so when we think of God, God's a God who's ready to hear, who's ready to help in time of need. This is what we find again in 1 Peter 5, verse 7. The Bible word there is to hurl, literally, to cast, to throw. Cast all your cares, anxieties upon Him. Why? Listen to this beautiful wordage. He cares for you. What's the result of God caring for you? I can cast my cares upon Him. He cares for me. The anxieties, the troubles, the difficulties we have, we can know and have confidence in the fact that God hears and that He's willing to answer those prayers and help His people who are in need. And so, when we think about prayer that God answers, you know, there's been a lot of damage done with the old country music song that Garth Brooks sang, Unanswered Prayers. I thank God for unanswered prayers. You know, for the child of God, that's really not correct language. And here's what we mean by that. When we say unanswered prayer, likely what we mean is, I prayed and the outcome was not what I wanted. But friend, that doesn't mean God didn't answer the prayer. If I ask, if I seek, if I pray to God, and whatever it is that I may be praying, just because the end result is not what I thought it ought to be, doesn't mean God didn't answer. Let me illustrate. The answer to prayer can come in several forms. Let's say that we're praying for somebody who's sick, and we're asking God to heal that person, and God hears our prayers. Friend, whether we like it or not, the answer may at times be no. It may not be in that person's best interest. It may not be for their spiritual outcome. It may not be best for the longevity of their life for that person to get well. And although God heard our prayer, God knew what was best in His infinite wisdom, and His answer, and He did answer it, may be no. And you know, that's the hard part. Sometimes I've got to realize my will may not be God's will. This is why Jesus prayed, not my will, but thine be done. Did God hear His prayer? Sure. Did God answer that prayer in the immediate sense which Jesus wanted it answered then? If it's possible, Father, let this cup pass from me. What was the answer? No, it's not possible. Jesus knew that in the moment that He saw and felt the struggle and the difficulty and temptation, God heard His prayer. But God's will interceded and overcame at that time. And then there may be another answer. The answer may be, not right now. Not just no, but not right now. In my own time, in my own way. The timing of working things out for the furtherment of His kingdom, for the betterment of His children, and for the overall purpose of salvation is dependent upon God's time, not ours. And so we may pray and God may say, the time's not right. Not right now may at times be the answer. Sometimes when we pray, it may be that things need to work out differently than what we realize. And then sometimes the answer may be yes. And we can positively identify certain times when that happens, and that's why we say, God answered my prayer. Well, friend, if we're walking in the light and we're a child of God, God answers our prayer every time, but the answer may not always be what we want it to be. And you know, when I look at my own life, when you look at yours, can't we really see times where we're glad that God was in control of that? Let me illustrate. Let's say that a man prays to take a different job, whatever that job may be, and he prays to God, and the answer is no to that job. And as life passes, as years pass, some other door opens up and it works out for his betterment, the betterment of his family, the betterment of the kingdom. And in the end result, that person looks at that scenario and he looks back and he says, how thankful to God I am that God knew better than I did. That other job may not have really been what he needed, may not have helped him develop spiritually, may not have been best for his family, best for the church. When we pray, let's have the attitude, not my will, but thine be done. And let's realize, just because God doesn't say yes, doesn't mean He doesn't answer. And thank God that God doesn't answer everything we want the way we want, because sometimes we don't always see things God's way. And so what do we know about prayer? Friend, we know positively that prayer is a very valuable asset for the child of God. Jesus used prayer multiple times throughout His ministry to praise God, to ask for help, to overcome the struggles in the garden, and to honor the almighty plan that God had set forth. But then we also see prayer like in the lives of Paul and Peter when they prayed in time of difficulty. And so we can gain strength from prayer to overcome and be victorious in this life. We're not just praying that things are going to naturally work out the way they are. We're asking God to help, and we're prefacing that with the Lord's will. Friend, ultimately, as 1 Peter 3 verse 12 says, the eyes of the Lord, they're on the righteous. His ears are open to their prayers, but the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. One thing we've certainly seen today is that God does not hear the prayer of those who are living in sin. His face is against those doing evil. If I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear. Friend, that alone ought to encourage and motivate one to make sure he is in a right relationship with God so that he can access and have the power of prayer. We ask you today, are you a child of God? Are you sure that you're in a relationship with God, knowing that God is able to hear your prayer? Friend, if you've never obeyed the gospel, more than anything, God loves you and wants you to become His child, and we do as well. The Scripture says God wants all men to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. 1 Timothy 2, verse 4. The Bible says that the Lord's not slow concerning His promises, as some men count slowness, but He's long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And friend, God so loved you, and He so loved me, that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Do you really believe that Jesus is God's Son? Do you believe it enough that you're willing to repent of things in your life that are not according to the will of God? Turn from sin and turn to God. Jesus said, unless you repent, you'll all likewise perish. Luke 13, verse 3. Would you confess the beautiful name of Jesus as the Son of God and Savior of the world? The Bible says in Romans 10, verse 10, with the heart, with the mind, one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. And having heard God's word, believed in Jesus, repented of your sin, and confessed His beautiful name, would you be immersed in water for the forgiveness of your sins? In Acts chapter 2, on the day of Pentecost, when they realized they had killed the Messiah and they were lost in sin, they cried out, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" And here was the answer, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of your sins." Have you obeyed the gospel? If not, friend, then God does not hear your prayer if one's regarding iniquity in his heart. But He can, and you can become a child of God. You can have access to one of the greatest powers in all the world, the power of prayer that has the power to overcome. If you're not a child of God, friend, we urge you to become one today. And if we are, let's utilize prayer. It truly has powerful results. You may have just joined our program and are wondering, what is the gospel of Christ? The gospel of Christ is an evangelistic work of the churches of Christ that reaches the whole world with the gospel through TV, radio, and internet. Our motto is to take the whole gospel to the whole world. We believe in having a book, chapter, and verse for everything we say and do. And unlike many religious groups today, we're concerned about lost souls, not your wife.
This is the gospel of Christ.
We encourage you to visit thegospelofchrist.com for a host of Bible study materials as well as audio and video copies of our lessons. If you would like to have a copy of today's lesson, please visit our website and fill out a media request form, or you can email us at mail@thegospelofchrist.com. Call us toll-free at 1-855-458-3905 or write to us at P.O. Box 788, McMinnville, Tennessee 37111.
This is the gospel of Christ.